بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. My dear students, welcome to you all on this day. And as you see here, today we will cover revision number 2, chapter number 10, up to chapter number 3. It means I'll give you or revise with you chapter number 10, 11, 12, up to 13. And previous lecture, I gave you revision 1, and we discuss also 3. Chapter number 8, 7, 8, 9. Today we will cover the other chapters in order to help you to understand and to revise with me these chapters. I'll tell you about the important sections, how we can make underline to the important line or subjects. So if you move here in chapter number 10, as I gave you before, the introductions, background, introductions, background to the post-colonialism, and also the historical developments of this chair, post-colonialism in section 3, as the empire writers back, and finally the methodology. You see in the first chapters here, you have to define, you have to learn how to define the term post-colonialism. As you see here in this slide, post-colonialism, or often post-colonialism without these, that deals with the effects of colonializations on cultures and societies, as also the originally used by historians after this the Second World War, in terms such as the post-colonial state. So post-colonial here had a clearly chronological meaning, designing the post-independence period. And also, I can say that, however, from the last 1917s, the term has been used by literary critics to discuss the various cultural effects or colonizations. Phil Ashcroft or Garth Griff, Helen Teef, post-colonialist studies the key concepts, wrote key guides in 208. So let me see now something about this slice. As you see now, post-colonialism here, it has a hyphen here between two words, and here without hyphen. So we will tell you, or I'll tell you next slices also the differences, or remind you about the differences between the first and the second. The second things you have to know, that this term, contemporary history, let me say, applied to denotes the immediate time after period during which power retreated or retreated from their colonial territories. Such is believed to be a problematic here applications on term, I told you also, as the immediate historical political time, and it is not included the categories of critical identity. So it deals with over inclusive terms of cultural representations, which are appropriated and replaced by post-colonial criticism. So this is in the introductions and how you have to learn what we mean by post-colonialism here. And in this slide, we are also going to tell you or remind you also about the historical developments of this term. I told you about the historical developments, that also it is going to representing the Western colonialism, and the term can also be used to describe, I told you, that the projects of reclaim and rethink the history and agency of people subordinated under the various forms of imperialism. So this is also here, as you see in this sections or slides. Post-colonialism is also intellectual directions the existence around the middle of the 20th century. It can be questions here, even a true or false, or it choose the second things here. It develops from the mainly refers to the times after colonialism. There, the post-colonial directions was created as colonial countries became independent. Nowadays, here, aspects of post-colonialism can be found not only in science concerning history, literatures, and politicals, but also in approach to culture and identity of both countries that we or were colonized, and also the former colonial powers. Finally here, however, post-colonialism can take the colonial times as well as the time after colonialism into considerations. So here you have to know that this is theory, and historians have been concerned with the investigating the various trajectory or of modernity as understood in or and experienced from a range of philosophical, cultural, and historical perspectives. So they have been particularly concerned with engaging with the ambiguous link of enlightenment as expressed in social, political, economic, scientific, legal, and cultural thought. So therefore, this is what can we say about the historical developments briefly in this term. So here we are going to chapter number 11. If you remember, the title was Structuralism. Structuralism here, you have to know the introduction of structuralism, then historical background as usual, and also literary criticism and the theory. Finally, practical criticism. I gave you about Pygmalion, and also I have to remind you about the practical criticism, which I gave you some also poems and also novels. Also I gave you a play, so you have to remember and revise these, because the majority I think the majority of the questions, also half, at least half the questions belong to practical criticism in final exam. So Pygmalion, one of these criticism or practical criticism, which we will also revise together today. But other practical criticism you can revise with yourself. I mean here the poems or sonnets, which is given to you before. So now let us open the first slides here and look at the structuralism. As you see, structuralists believed in the introductions, I mean here, believe that every system has a structure, and also that structures are the real things that lie beneath the surface of or the appearance of meaning. So what does it mean? It means that first of all, you have to know that when I say structuralism, it means an intellectual tendency that seeks to understand and explain social reality, I mean here, in terms of social structures. So structures here, structures are defined as the pattern and forms of social relations and combinations among a set of social elements or components apart, such as positions, units, levels, regions. I told you are also about the locations and social formations. So structuralism here we consider as a knowledge. When we say structuralism, we can say knowledge of nature, knowledge of natures and the human life that also interest in relationship rather than individual objects or alternatives, where objects are defined by the sets of relationships of which they are part, and not by the qualities possessed by them taken in isolations. So this is what we mean here by structuralism as a chair or a part. Now, historical background of this chair or structuralism. First of all, about backgrounds, I have to remind you about 1916. In this period, this approach, the studying literatures called at that time structuralism, became popular, and also in the Swiss linguists, Ferdinand Saussure, the fathers of modern linguistics, influence here, and this is theory through his dissemination of language as a system of called semiology. So this is also about the background here. I can say that this academy or this structuralism, I mean here, for the first time started in 19th century and then reappeared in the second half of the 20th century. When it grow here, it becomes one of the most popular approaches in academic field, and also concerned with the analysis of language, cultural, and society. So the work here, or the term structuralism itself, appeared in the work of the French, and also gave rise in France to the structuralist movement, which also secured the work of thinkers in the diverse. So in background here, structuralism was corresponded to a particular moment in Western history. It expressed, I can say, a certain degree of self-hearted, also of the rejections or of the traditional Western cultural. This is also some about backgrounds of the structuralism. Also here in chapter 12, if you look at it, chapter 12, you will find that the developments of the American short story. In the developments of the American short story, I discussed with you introductions, developments of the American short story in these chapters, and finally also the critical discussion of the selection sophistications. Now, sophistications here, one of our discussion will be, so let us look at the introductions of the American short story and read the first one here. And knowing how it develops also, if you look in this slice, you will find that a short story is a work of fictions. You have to know if it is true or false. That is usually written in a prose. We can underline and make a questions, easy question to make false, for example, or true. Often in narrative format. This formative tends to be more pointed than longer works of fiction, such as novella in the 20th century and also 21st century tales, in the novels or boxes. Short story definitions based upon length differ somewhat even among professional writers, due somewhat in part to fragmentation of the medium into genre. So I can say that American short story here has evolved both in form and contents. I told you, I inform you about these lines, that American short story evolved both in form here concerned and also in contents. Like other genres, the short story has evolved through various movements and the traditions such as realism, modernism, and also postmodernism. However, it has also remained unique because of publishing opportunities that differ from longer works such as the novel. So I can see the short story genre shares elements or fictions with the novel traditionally consisting of characteristics such as plot, characters, setting, point of view, themes, and writing style. All these the elements of fictions or novel. Although the short story shares elements of literatures, also you have to keep in mind and writing devices with other literary genre. These things about the introductions of American short story. Now look about the developments of the short story. If you look at the developments here, you will find that the developments of short story in the 20th century requires going back in time to the 19th, since most of the developments of this genre occurred while realism was the dominant literary movement, especially in fictions, also in that century. So this is very important. It can be in your final exam here. The developments of the short story in the 20th century requires going back in time to 19th. Here you can underline and you can prepare yourself for questions as usual, choose or true or false, I mean multiply choices or even essay questions. So this is I mean here by this developments that the American shown thousands of literary experimentations, particularly in the criticism, novel, drama, poetry, short stories, and so on. So several short types in American were assimilated to give compared to particularly a new product, the popular short story of the 19th century. Opinion here varies as to which particular author is actual innovators. So Washington here, Irving, one of the creator here or founder of the short story in American, is regarded as the father of American short story. Washington here, Irving, born in 1783 up to 1859, aimed his vertical sketches, produced story like Reb Van Winkle and also the Legends of Sleepy Hollow, with a structures well balanced and restrained. So you have to revise Washington here as the father, we said, of the American short story, and know his autobiography about him. And you can go back to previous slices or lecture which I discussed to you, and here in this developments also you have to revise that the 19th century was the first to renew or started the short story. Here in this short story I gave you example about sophistications. I choose sophistications as a term of indicative and one of the major story here. Sophistications by Sherrod Anderson, and really if you look at it as a subject or a themes, you will find many interesting here and attractive theme. So first of all, if you look at the subject here, you look at the plot as open with the descriptions of life in a small American town. Look about the small American town. Now I'm talking about the setting of this story. How is it important to make analysis or a critical analysis or discussion? Winsburg, the name of the small village in Iowa. It is early evening, and what we mean by early evening? Early evening referring to what here? To calm, to something invisible and others things also. Evil also in the month of November. All right, all these referring or symbolize of something. You have to go back to the setting of this story. The roads of the towns are dusty and full of the hard brown leaves which have fallen off the trees. Look, the writers here choose this month of the year, November, not summer or not spring, and of course he or winter, he choose the November, I mean here autumn, and autumn also as a season referring to many things, not positive but negative, I can say here. So leaves which is brown and falling off, also referring to the protagonists here to get some knowledge or informations about what will happen in the story, about especially the main characters of the story. So the town here is crowded with horses and people have or who have come to attend the fair, which is a major event here. The story then moves to focus on two. How many main characters which the story is move? Only two, not three, not one. All right, they are two. The story is moved to focus on two characters. The all characters will only focus on these two main characters. And here what we mean by sophistications. All right, the first is George Willard. We started by the characters of the George, and the second is Helen White. So the term of sophistications is indicative of one of the major themes in the story. Linguistically, I told you that sophisticated is the opposite of simple, meaning either profound or refined. The concept is related to what is happening to both George and Helen. If we want to talk about these protagonists or these characters as main characters, both are young. And in this sense, somewhat innocent, simple, and also I can see unsophisticated, but on the other hand, both of them are growing up, maturing or becoming experienced and somewhat sophisticated here. So sophistication then is largely associated with the growing up. Keep it in mind. Sophistication is largely associated with the growing up. What distinguishes adulthood from childhood is the awareness of the complexity and of life. So sophistication has both negative and positive implications. If we want to talk about negative, because the individual becomes less secure, less happy, and also less carefree. But if we want to talk about positive, I told you before that because one becomes wiser and profounder and also more experienced. So this is the title here. I'm talking about the title of sophistications and what we mean by it and how it relate with the characters in this story. So this is some briefly about sophistications. Let us go now to chapters number 13 and look about the title, the first half of the 20th century. The first half of the 20th century started by the introductions of this age and all period, and also 1901 up to 1922 modernism, then poetry, drama, and novel of this first half of the 20th century. Now, if you look at the introduction, this chapter will be focused on English language literature rather than the literatures of English. And I told you how we can make differences between literatures, English language literatures, and literature of English. I mean here that includes writers from the literatures of England here. You see, not as English language literatures. English language literatures here means writers from Scotland, Wales, and whole of Ireland, as well as literatures in English here from former only colonies, and it is also include to some extent the U.S. Though the main article here is American literatures. This article will be only, or this chapters only, talking about American literatures. Modernism here, if we want to talk about it as a major literary movement of the first part of the 20th century. So, in the first part of the 20th century, modernism was present here. The term postmodern literature is used to describe certain tendencies in post-war World War II literatures. So, the year here between 1900 up to 1945 were very difficult for humanity. Why? Because too many wars, we have two wars, one and two, and also in the period, not only were there two world wars only to survive, but also some of the worst parts of the social, economic, and bad environmental challenge here of developments all began to make themselves felt. So the one era in which progress was made was in the social context in which the rights of workers and welfare state expanded. The idea of developments, especially for the development world, also evolved in this period. So I can say also in the economic era, the world went up and then it crashed in the Great Depressions, producing negative results that were unprecedented. So many actions in this period, or especially in the first half of this period, was happened here in 1901 up to 1922 modernism. The early 20th century literary modernism developed in the English speaking world due to a general sense of this disillusionment with the Victorian's era attitude or certainty, let me say conservations, and also believe in the idea of objective truth. About poetry here, if we want to talk about this period, I can add it here. I mean a major British lyric poet of the first decade of the 20th century was Thomas Hardy. Please, it is very important. Again, I can repeat, a major British lyric poet of the first decades of the 20th century was Thomas Hardy, 1840 up to 1928. True or false? This is one you have to understand. And the second thing you have to know that though a modernist, Hardy here was an important transitional figures between the Victorian era and the 20th century. So a major novelist of the late 19th century, Hardy, after the adverse criticism of his last novel, Jude of Obscure or Concentrated on Publishing Poetry. This is one what I want you to understand in this sections or in this slide, especially in the first half of the century, that in this period, especially Hardy or Thomas Hardy was the first decades of the 20th century. All right, and he was a major British lyric poet and also a critics. All right, so about the poetry of this century, literature's here, a major modernist poet, Irishman, W.P. Yeats, in 1865 up to 1939, began late in the Victorian era. In poetry here, also, we can see that literature in the 20th century begins with a series of movements, some of them, let me say, contradictory, between them, symbolism, impressionism, and also Hispanic literature's modernism, and also the generations of 98. So this is also a drama in this age. A drama here, Irish playwright George Bernard Shaw. George Bernard Shaw here in 1856 up to 1950, and also G.M. Singh in 1871 up to 1909 were influential in British drama. I choose only Shaw because he is the best and the major playwright in this age. Shaw's hair career began in the last decades of the 19th century, while Singh's plays belong to the first decades of the 20th century. And here, two lines you have also to know and underlined because it is also important. So during the first decades of two literary conceptions are imposed to writers, those writers for whom literary work is the expressions of cultural experience and fallen intellectualism, and writers who also, in view of the cases of the times and also dissatisfactions of the to see literary work as an adventure and as original experience. So this is what we mean by the first half of the 20th century American short story. You have to understand and revise sophistications, very important in this or in previous chapters. And in this chapters, you have to read the poetry and the drama of this modernism, or in this first half of the 20th century. You have to look also about John Dryden, Thomas Hardy, especially Thomas Hardy as a British lyric poet, and also George Bernard Shaw, what he over or introduced in this age. So you can go back to your text, which I sent to you, and you will find everything in these chapters. So I hope that I give you what you want to know about literary criticism. I know there are many chapters, but you have to know that when we say literary criticism, we are talking about one of the major term or subjects or course in your department as English department. So you have to know these writers and how you can make analysis and how you can make paragraphs and understand what you can read, all right, or what the writers or the authors want you to understand. So therefore, these subjects when you read. I choose only the important things. I omitted many paragraphs and many sections during your text, and only I gave you the important, which I feel that it is a necessity to understand for you. So therefore, this is the time to talk about now the novelists as the final here sections of this chapters here, William Faulkner and Rudyard Kipling. These writers here as a novelists also you will find in your final exam. These here as a question, the sounds and the fairy in 1929 is another significant modernist novel that used the stream of consciousness technique here. So what he used as a novelist here, and what he introduced in these techniques and his styles, William Faulkner, you will find also in your paper or in your material which I sent to you. Then Rudyard Kipling as a novelist who are not also considered. I can omit or cancel this not, right, and only say novelists who are considered here. So you have to know that always not, you have to underline and prepare yourself to make a questions here or for a questions. Modernist includes Rudyard Kipling in 1865-1936, who was also a successful poet at G. Wells in 1866 and 1946, John Glossworthy in 1867 up to 1933, and he got also Nobel Prizes in Literature in 1932. So these novelists here are giving us to say that we discussed now everything here, and also I revised with you the important things in four chapter number 10, 11, 12, 13. And you should also revise and make notes about every point you read and feel that it is important. Prepare yourself and be ready to answer the questions. Will be not difficult, inshallah. This is everything about the revisions. If you need any information or anything, any knowledge, in the Zoom meeting, we will also discuss together what we also want to discuss. So the time is time over, and we are going to finish. And until I meet you, let me say time to say goodbye and see you.